Hi guys, and welcome back to Brain-Friendly Thinking. A lot of the techniques which I introduced in my past videos help you to become more knowledgeable in an area, to become an expert, and by that to help you to become more creative. But is it even necessary to become an expert in order to be more creative? Let's look at the connections between creativity and expertise in more detail. Usually when we think about creativity, we think it's all about getting ideas. And while this is an important part, this is not the be-all and end-all of creativity. When Apple introduced the original iPhone back in the day, they didn't just combine smartphone technology with a better user interface. They had to understand the problems of their customers, the shortcoming of their competitor products, the opportunity that a new direction would offer. And then they had to take potential solutions and evaluate them. How well can they fulfill the need of the customer? And all of that is what makes the iPhone such a success and change the way we think about what a smartphone is. All of the above requires that we are able to recognize patterns. Take this painting, for instance. Even if you're not from a European country, you're probably able to recognize that this is the Last Supper. You know that the bloke in the center is Jesus Christ and that the other people around him are his disciples. If you know anything about the story behind the Last Supper, you can also probably guess from the agitated look on the faces and the way in which people speak to one another that it is very likely that Jesus just announced that one amongst the myths is going to denounce him. You probably think that this is the famous painting by Leonardo da Vinci. However, if you were an art historian, you would know from 100 tiny details that this is in fact not the famous painting by Leonardo, but a copy of that painting by another Renaissance painter called Andrea Solari. On the other extreme, if you had never been exposed to Western culture before, you might not even recognize that this is a religious painting. The only thing you'd be able to see is there are a couple of people talking to each other and sharing a meal. Maybe you can tell that the guy in the center is important. But all the other level of detail is completely close to you. From that we see that recognizing patterns is not about whether we recognize it or we don't recognize it, but rather it's a continuous line. And the more we know about a certain subject, the more we can read out from our data. And data is all around us, in what we read, what we see, what we hear, what we feel. But how can knowledge help us to see patterns? Thinking, for the most part, is association. We are bombarded every second of our life by a myriad of information and stimuli from all around us. And every stimulus which we perceive with one of our senses, our eyes, our fingers, our ears, sets in motion a cascade of associations. It basically, as it travels through the brain, goes through several stations, and each of the stations is specialized in a particular type of pattern recognition. We have another set of modules in our brain which are tasked with creating patterns, and the patterns they create are the way in which we move our body, the words we speak, even the decisions we make. But in order for each of these brain areas to operate, it is necessary that they receive input from other areas and that they compare this input with what is already known in the brain. And the great thing is that we can change it. As we're learning new things about a specific topic, we're getting better at recognizing patterns. We're able to recognize patterns we could not recognize before. And our brain changes itself in such a way that working with patterns in this specific topic becomes more and more efficient. But that's a change that's not abrupt. It's rather a gradual transition. This led Gary Klein to coin the metaphor of the rhodopsin effect. Rhodopsin is the chemical compound in our eyes that allows us to see in dimly lit conditions. Experts are able to see structures and patterns that non-experts are not able to see, because they accumulated rhodopsin in their specific area of interest. And as you know, if you go from a well-lit room to a dimly lit room, your ability to see shapes and structures in this new room does not suddenly change from not at all to everything. But it's a continuous process that takes several minutes to complete. And as the rhodopsin accumulates in your eyes, more and more of the shapes in the room become visible. Which means that our ability to perceive pattern is not a general ability that is just better in some people than in others. It highly depends on the topic we're talking about. So where does that leave us? It tells us a couple of things. First of all, it makes no sense to talk of a creative person. Whether a person is creative or not always depends on what topic we're talking about. And from not creative at all to highly creative, there's a continuum in between. Secondly, specialization is good. I know very often we think of specialists as people who know more and more about less and less. But really, if you want to do something great, if you want to be really creative, and if you want to change something, you need to pick an area of expertise and you need to start digging deeper. The deeper you go, the better you are at working with patterns, and the more likely it is that you will come up with good and with creative solution. I would even go so far as to say that even people we generally consider to be generalists are actually specialists as well. It just so happens that the topic of expertise cuts across the mental silos we usually think in. So if you want to become highly creative, what can you do? First of all, you need to select one or a handful of topics where you want to be creative. Secondly, you need to accumulate knowledge or skills within this particular topic or topics. Then you need to play around with the contents of that topic so that the topic always stays fresh in your mind and that you see that there's more than one way how you can combine the individual subparts of the topic with one another. This will prevent you from falling into expert blindness, and it gives you that edge that if a problem or an opportunity presents itself to you, you can recognize it, seize it, and work with it in such a way that you'll be able to produce a pattern which might be creative, but it is certainly very relevant to the problem or the opportunity you're trying to solve. So, what's your focus topic? Make sure you spend enough time during the day working with that topic to make sure that you can also produce creative solutions. And that's how you can harness the power of being an expert. If your area of expertise is knowledge-based, there are a couple of tools that can help you. You might be interested at checking out the concept of a Zettelkasten, which is a method for personal knowledge management, or you might be interested in a couple of games which you can play to make working with your knowledge fun, and at the same time it allows you to make new discoveries about your area of expertise. If you found the video useful, please don't forget to give the like button a high five. Consider subscribing if you haven't already. And until next time, keep thinking.